सर, जोर्जन एलुमनाई सेल केजीएमयू एंड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ माइक्रोबायोलॉजी. दिस इज गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट योर थ्री ग्रुप थर्ड लेक्चर्स. दिस इज लेक्चर इन एसोसिएशन विद द जोर्जन एलुमनाई एसोसिएशन. टुडे लेक्चर मैम हु विल बी डिलीवर द लेक्चर ऑन इंपॉर्टेंट on moral dilemma of doctors COVID-19
इसको आ रही है
मुझे लगा कुछ लोग
डबल लगा हुआ है शायद.
I request that you try to please switch center. राजकुमार देखो एक से ज्यादा सिस्टम तो नहीं खुले तुम्हारे यहाँ.
एक से ज्यादा सिस्टम
Everyone is requested to please stay muted.
Please mute off for the
Birla. Khula hua hai.
हाँ ये भी खुला है. दीक्षा का तो सब हम लोग नोट कर लिए.
ठीक है.
नोट करिए सब लोग प्लीज.
थैंक यू.
ओके मैम. तो टुडेज स्पीकर इज डॉक्टर नियल नाग मैम. वो विल डिलीवर इंपॉर्टेंट एंड यूजफुल लेक्चर इन करंट सिनेरियो on moral dilemma of doctors during COVID-19 and ethical issue. So before inviting our guest speaker, I welcome on behalf of alumni officers our vice chancellor sir, Dr. Lieutenant General VP Puri sir, who gave us permissions and blessings for this series of lectures. And I also welcome our International President of Georgian Alumni Association, Dr. S.D. Pandey sir, our National President, Dr. A.M. Kaur sir, of Alumni Association, Dean Faculty of Medicine, Dr. Uma Singh ma'am, our Dean Dental, Dr. R.K. Singh sir, Georgian Alumni Association, all faculty members of the Georgian. Especially our HOD ma'am also, who is the architect of this series of lectures. Other faculty members of my department who joined and are members of alumni association and other category who joined this lecture from outside and inside both. And the chairperson for today's lectures will are Dr. Vilavankatesh ma'am, Professor Microbiology. So he is also a friend of our guest speaker and Dr. Suruchi Shukla. So I now invite our persons, Dr. Vilavankatesh ma'am, who will introduce our speakers. Please, ma'am. Vimla ma'am, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to introduce my very dear friend. And of course, an eminent, the very apex of her career, Dr. Vijayalakshmi Nath. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, I always keep wondering how I should introduce Dr. Vijayalakshmi, so because she's such a dear friend that actually saying dear friend for me is the biggest introduction I can give. But on the professional level, Dr. Vijayalakshmi Nag is an MD in microbiology and she started her MD in 1988 and she is many things, but currently she is the member ethics and medical registration board in the National Medical Commission on deputation from being the professor and head of microbiology at All India Institute of Science, Medical Science. She became a member at the National Medical Commission, a full-time member of Ethics and Medical Registration, 25th September 2020. The National Medical Commission, as we all know, is the new replacement of the Medical Council of India. Dr. Vijayalakshmi Nag started her career in microbiology 30 years back when she joined as an MD student at KGMU, and so she is a very precious alumni, very senior alumnus. She went on to become a lecturer in MKCG Medical College, Behrampur, Orissa, husband, in 1993. Then she came back to Lucknow. She has a really long and varied career. She came back to Lucknow as a senior resident in 1998. And she was assistant professor at our very own college here in KGMU from 1999 to 2004. So our journey together actually was in SGPGI and KGMU, and of course for a lifetime afterwards. Want to become an assistant professor in SGPGI, where she served till 2009, and then she moved as a scientist I to National Institutes of Biologicals, Noida, where she did a really stellar job. She stayed there till 2013 before going on to All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Jodhpur. In 2013, she went there as professor and head of microbiology. In this long career, she has had 167 publications. She has served on many important positions. She was dean research at AIIMS Jodhpur from 1st August 2020, and she was a boss. Some of them are Professor UC Chaturvedi Oration Award in 2021 by the UK Association of Medical Microbiology, chapter of IMM. And she has also received the Lifetime Achievement Award in Health and Medical Sciences by the Viva Award 2019. She is a member of many professional bodies, and for today's purposes, the first one, that is that she's a full-time member of Ethics and Medical Registration Board in the National Medical Commission, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, is what is the most important for today's lecture actually, where she's going to be speaking on the model dilemma of doctors during COVID-19. We all faced, there has been a huge moral dilemma among doctors in many, many ways, which Dr. Vijayalakshmi will explain to her. I see our Honorable Vice Chancellor. So before, sir, would you like to say a couple of words before we move to the speaker?
So I think you've spoken the lots of words. I think we're all looking forward to hearing the speaker now.
Okay, sir. Introducing our Honorable Vice Chancellor, General Vipin Puri, is here with us. And now I'll request Dr. Vijayalakshmi Nag to please speak the moral dilemma of doctors during the COVID-19 and ethical dilemma. An ethical issue. Dr. Vijayalakshmi?
Yes, yes.
Can you hear me?
Thank you, Dr. Vijayalakshmi. Respected Dr. Puri sir, Dr. Sharma sir, Dr. Uma and Dr. Amita, dear Dr. Vimla, Dr. Kalyan, Dr. Suruchi, and all alumni members. It gives me immense pleasure to be with you and a part of this academic exchange program. I congratulate the organizers for this beautiful event and giving us the opportunity to speak on the topic dilemma, moral dilemma of doctors during COVID-19 and ethical issue. This is the issue that gradually emerging from the pandemic that the world is experiencing. Before I start, I am making a declaration that even though I am a member of Ethics and Medical Registration Board of the Commission, I am not representing here as an academic representing this. And I am only representing here as an academician, and the presentation is purely based on published literature and newspaper. During last 1.5 years, experiences a pandemic that is unique and unprecedented in many aspects. The pandemic caught us unprepared and wrong-footed. Many people suffered, them lost their lives. Based by the recent information, there were nearly 5 lakh deaths in India, even though the pandemic showing a decline continue to happen every day. This is as per publication in Times of India just the month back. All throughout, the focus has been on the patients, the community, diagnosis, treatment, and prevention aspect. That has emerged from the shadow of all these aspects is about the caregivers in the healthcare workers. The pressure of managing the problem under serious constraints and adverse circumstances took a great toll on the doctors and other healthcare workers. The uncertain different level with a huge workload have put the ethical and moral values into serious test. What is ethics? What is morality? Is it same for individual and public health? What is the moral and ethical dilemma faced by doctors at different places? What are the factors affecting them? What are the solutions available, and what are the solutions be made for further solving this burning problem? I will try to give answer to these questions in my presentation. Much with the microbiology. So here all are very great microbiologists are in the LNI association. So I wanted to bring some other selected the topic, some other topic, not but then also COVID-19 is there, so full topic is on the microbiology only. What is the ethics or morality? Ethics and moral are mostly used as synonymous terms, but actually they are different. Ethics is basically the rules provided by the external sources like the institution, organization, and can be bound by law. Morality is individual's own conscience and principles. I can explain it by an example. If we see the animal experiment which we are performing in the laboratory, by the moral we can think this is not right. We always say no, animal experiment should not be done, and the animal should not be sacrificed. But ethically this is right. So there is the difference between the ethics and the morality. So some of this has been defined that ethics is the study of morality, careful and systematic reflection on and moral decision and behavior, whether past, present, or future. Ethics is a matter of knowing. However, the morality is the value dimension of human decision making. It includes the rights, responsibilities, and virtues, good and just. Morality is a matter of doing. So, the ethical priorities, if we see, do care. What are the ethical priorities? Respect for the patient, autonomy, maturity, and allegiance to each patient, all may not get. But in cases of public health crisis where the pandemics occur, the standard of care is changed. And this is respect for common good, not individual autonomy. Less autonomy for practitioners, maximize benefit to the greatest number of people, not the individual focus on the patient. Allocate scarce resources and responsibility. And in this case also, but the ethical priorities are these. what the world has learned, the COVID-19 is from the last 1.5 years. So in past 1.5 years, the world, the importance of public health measures as never before in the recent past, such as physical distancing, quarantine of international travelers in their contracts, isolation of people with infection, hand hygiene measures, cough etiquettes, wearing of face masks, all have been promoted aggressively. Also, the lockdown of all travel work, social education, and the economic activities for a protected period of time. Focus only on patient, it shows also, the world also has learned that the focus is not enough. The individual patient is not to be taken care of, but due to the COVID, the distinction between the individual and public health is very narrow. Pandemic like COVID pandemic, where this is due to the infection process, the individual and public health, the emergence of moral and ethical issues because of these occurs, and what are the types of moral and ethical issues developed during this COVID pandemic? The basic issue faced by the doctors regarding treatment of two group of people infected with the COVID-19 virus and people not infected with the COVID-19. There is a constant and rapid spread of virus during pandemic. The crisis faced by healthcare sector worldwide lead to an unprecedented rise in the demand for a huge influx of the patient in ICU of hospitals, with difference in the level of critical condition. This has led to the overburdening of the public healthcare system as well as healthcare workers and frontliners, who are also constantly at high risk of contracting the virus, risking themselves, and the excess demand for care is also leading to the need for development of triage and prioritizing patients based on their need and condition. All these are leading to the development of considerable ethical dilemma in public health sector across the globe. What ethics tells us in this situation where the crisis are there? The importance of ethics in the public healthcare system cannot be denied. And ethics tells us in this situation that when there are diversity of opinion, we must respect the value of others. However, we should defend our own. Ethics helps to maintain the dignity, integrity, and welfare of the patient by holding the care provider accountable for their action. So during the pandemic, there are a huge number of patients require admission, but due to scarcity of the bed, all of them could not be provided ICU care. So they were kept on the triage system. But there are many factors that influence the ICU. Person could have more than one factors, like the patient's age was equal, or if the patient is younger and he was suffering hypertension, or if the patient is older and he is suffering with the diabetes, and the difficult to prioritize these patients. So there are different various factors which are in the decision on the triage system could not be taken. Apart from this, there are social and family factor for which effect is processed. So in the ethical, the development of triage, provision and withdrawal of ICU and life support regarding family visits, quality of care provided, and providing services at the risk of the welfare of the care provider and their families. These are the ethical dilemmas which we are regarding, because we are not distinguishing much between the ethical and moral dilemmas. So, but if we distinguish even also, then the moral dilemmas are decision between their safety and patient welfare. Whether should I save myself or to the patient, damage to the autonomy of the patients, decision-making of the use of the hospital and clinic resources, prioritization of the patients based on their practice. Unethical practice during normal situations might become an ethical practice during pandemic. In case of utter scarcity, victims should have no preference over normal patient. So there we are, these are the different types of the ethical and moral dilemmas arises during the COVID pandemic. Before serve the pandemic, the clinician is actually trained to treat individual patient, but here he is forced to adopt the public measures, which is totally different. Even in individual treatment, clinical ethics and communication takes a back seat, especially in emergencies leading to development of moral stress. Patient in isolation are not visited regularly. Even if they do, they visit with emotionless robotic PPE and without taking. This takes away the mental treatment part of the patient is seriously hampered. What is the relation between the patient and the doctor? The patient, if the doctor is coming, if he is discussing to the patient, he is touching the patient, his attitude, his smile is valued by the patient. But when the doctor is going in the robotic manner and with the full PPE, the patient and doctor's relation is not there. And this is also another thing which is very, this was happened in the COVID-19. So according to the Hippocrates, cure sometimes, treat often, and comfort always. But this was least in cases of the COVID. So working with uncertain evidence and unproven therapies. Now these are the dilemmas which we are going to discuss one by one. Number one, the working with uncertain evidence and unproven therapies. What we have, if the body wanted to be safe and the doctors and healthcare workers were also wanting that they should save the patient. And there were no clinical trial, no proofs were available. Even then, the different types of the medicines were started immediately. Azithromycin, hydrochloroquine, ivermectin, vitamin D, C, zinc, oseltamivir, lopinavir, favipiravir, remdesivir. So these are the different medicines were started, although the clinical trials were not been done. Then tocilizumab, which is the against the cytokine storms, this has also been tried, and then the immunoglobulins, and now the cocktail. So the doctors is really distressed whether should start these things or not, although there was the guidelines were coming from the hospital, from the upper appellate authorities. And these drugs and medicine also having the side effects, then also these were started, and so no definitive treatments for severe cases were there. So the working with uncertain evidence, this is another factors which created the dilemma in the doctors. Second is duty to care versus right to protection. This was the next dilemma. The doctor was working with high viral load exposure without the even without PPE, because we cannot compare all the hospital, all the institute in the same. So there were scarcity of the PPE according to the they were only available according to their they were supplied from the external sources. So high number of death among healthcare worker and the desperate appeal to governments where they are about them also, then the problem of getting one infected, like the one person was infected, then doctor self can be infected. If the patient was infected, the doctor could be infected from this, and the doctor can infect the family, can infect the friend, and what other he is losing. He was losing work hours loss, he was taking leave, and so leave loss, and if infecting others and also covering the colleagues. So problem was not only the infected one person, there was a chain of infection from one person to the community. And second is the reciprocity of from health system, PPE, duty hours, restriction, rooms, incentives and compensation, they should be given to the and offered to the healthcare workers. How next dilemma was how to distribute the limited resources. If the doctors were given the charge or healthcare worker was in the charge, how to distribute the limited resources? Scarcity of the bed, ventilator, medicine, ICU and laboratory tests. Huge influx of the patient to ICU, restrict the decision to alert, save life, whether the person is suffering with the comorbidity or the saving of the life depending upon the age, if younger age group should be taken care of or the important people should be taken care of, whether it is VIP or healthcare worker, so to whom they should save the life. And this all was related to the community. So the guidelines to clarify the above cause should be formulated. Then next dilemma was inability to give dignified death. If you remember, during the peak period of the COVID pandemic, there was so much rush of the patients, and even the family members were coming and leaving the relatives without any attendant. So the patient might die alone in the hospital, no chance to say goodbye, nobody was there, and so he was alone, and this was also worrying to the doctor. Body not handed over, difficulty in performing rituals and cremations, doctors are also not spared in this case. So death before test results are out. Even so much fear was there, the persons were admitted in the hospital even on a mere very minimal symptoms, and later on it was proved that the test was negative. So and the patient died due to any other disease. So these were the other dilemma points in the doctors. Next is the basic or the main concern of the doctors were clinical care of patient with COVID-19. This is another dilemma which developed during the COVID period. So if we know that the COVID patients are mainly divided into three groups, the asymptomatic or the mild cases, the moderate and severe. But the treatment in all the cases, if you see, either the isolation or the unproven therapy, the therapy was based not on the clinical trial, not on the such many groups, and the separation from family and relatives. So, and also compromise in routine care, doubtful efficacy, whether these drugs having any efficacy or not, and if the patient was in ICU, so the triage facility, whether the patient should be given on what type of the priority for the admission, if ICU facilities are not available. And the ethical problems was regarding the cleanliness. If we remember, the various nursing homes, various hotels, and various other places were also changed into the COVID wards. So there was the problem with the cleanliness. Who will clean? Who will maintain? Where the waste will be disposed? And because they were isolated, nobody was bothering. So the patients were lonely. And so there was harm to mental health of the patient. And there were lack of the PPE also, and the scarcity of the resources. So the inadequate care, and even if the patient was going to die, there was no dignity in the death. So, and the basic concerns regarding the ICU, well, the basic aim was when the patients were rushing to the ICU with the serious conditions during the COVID, the basic aim was to maximum lives, to prioritize ICU bed for patients with the best prognosis. It was not done in a single place, but even all the hospital, there was the trial system was maintained how to admit in the ICU because there were less ICU facilities, even in very developed hospital and institute also. To increase it all, that the equipment is okay or not, whether the area is fulfilling the requirement of ICU or not, but to increase the ICU beds, to organize transfer to distant ICU with more beds available, but it has a very serious, because shifting of the serious patient to other available area where the ICU is there is also a very tricky thing. It's not a simple to just change the patient from one ICU to the other ICU, or to accelerate withdrawal of life support in ICU by making the tries ki when the patient is very serious, they can withdraw the support and was giving the support to less serious cases who was able to survive. So, and then the visit of families prohibited or strongly limited, and adequate communication between caregivers and families were disrupted. So the patients were going into mental stress and trauma. Concern about patients without COVID-19 requiring ICU admission. Everything during the COVID-19 was going on, but nobody was concerned about the patient without COVID-19, and they suffered a lot. So the care of non-COVID patients, denying non-COVID, non-emergencies, lack of support for mental illness, conversion of hospital to COVID center, so even non-COVID patients were not getting any hospital services. Basic care are considered non-emergencies. And so leaving the serious things are the basic things, the even serious things were had not getting any place in the hospital. Shutting down a private hospital, small clinics, it also create the crisis in the healthcare system. Worst hit the maternity and child health and the patient suffering with the cancers. Even patient suffering with the non-communicable diseases like the heart, lung and kidney diseases, and also the blood transfusion services were suffered. So not only the COVID cases, the non-COVID patients were neglected and were not getting any support from the hospital. Death due to lockdown and isolation, the families were living apart, so they could not come. And the mental health, and the person was, even the normal person was getting the going into the depression and opting the suicide. Alcohol withdrawal and illicit liquor death, lack of access to emergency services, lack of transport, scarcity of resources, lack of supply to the hospital. So the WHO said that Ebola pandemic death due to non-Ebola was much more than the virus. So we don't know what is the data regarding the non-COVID death during this last 1.5 year, but is must be very surprising. So all these dilemmas given a moral distress to the healthcare worker, that is the doctors. Lack of preparedness, they were not very much prepared. And then conflict between response to individual patient versus response to publics. Then should they turn whistleblower? These all because the hospital was not prepared, the individual doctor was not prepared, even the healthcare system was not prepared. So what they should do? Whether they turn only the whistleblower, go and inform to media, and then they would get the punishment or measure to correct the setting up after. So these moral distress could be solved by arranging the webinars and the counseling these type of healthcare workers who are going to care for the COVID cases. And ethics help line or clinical ethics consultation should have been created. So seeing all these dilemmas, few suggestions were given suggestions are mainly from the published reports. And number one, that is the institution should make clear plan, policies and standard operating procedure, not only for COVID-19, but the institution should be ready for any such type of crisis if going to come in the future, because the pandemic is coming every decades. So why should the institution is not ready? Then the availability of the patient care, safety equipment, and this stratification protocol must be communicated clearly. But there should not be hiding. There should be clear-cut demonstration, clear-cut communication, what is available and what is required. Periodically brief them regarding the safety concern. And as COVID-19 duty is admittedly stressful, institution may consider giving reduced shift hours. Presently, the COVID-19, the doctors who were giving the duty, they were 6 to 8 hours, but should be reduced up to 4 hours. No guidelines formed at even after 20 years of SARS pandemic earlier. Consider giving accommodation and quarantine facilities for its staff at least during COVID duties. These accommodation and quarantine facilities were developed by the few hub institutions and hospitals, but not to all places. Pre-counseling regarding the moral and ethical issues of the doctor before going to the front line. Like what could be the moral and ethical issues could be arises. So you can prepare and pre-counsel the doctors and healthcare workers before sending to the front line. Involvement of mental health professional to enable utilization of their specific expertise in crisis. And setting up of a COVID support cell in every institution. Healthcare team leaders should be trained to recognize sign of burnout among junior doctors for early identification and interventions. Provide training to use resource rationally. Strict regular COVID auditing and assessment. There must not be any attempt to cover up shortcomings. Declaration of a fine against fake news about the pandemic. There were so many fake news in the media and even in the newspaper. So they should be punished. Strict Coronavirus Act, emergency registration of the health professional. So the healthcare professional could get the benefit, if any, from the government. Give them emergency power for next 6 months so they can decide and they tackle with the crisis. And these are the points which was being circulated during the COVID to remain calm. This also applicable for the doctors, not only the healthcare workers. Stay in touch. In fact, you are also isolated, but in infectious environment. Get accurate information and don't be overburdened. Take a breath, stop, take a breath, calm down, walk it off. A small exercise is enough, and give and get support from your colleagues. But still, if you are sad, you are getting angry, you are confused, you are scared, it's okay. It's normal. Confront it. Talk to someone and seek help.
डॉक्टर विजय आप अपना स्लाइड शेयर करिए.
मैम क्या अभी खत्म हो गया?
नहीं कहीं दिख नहीं रहा है आपका स्लाइड. okay. छोटा हो गया है मैंने. इट्स नॉट विजिबल. प्लीज शेयर करिए फिर से.
ओके okay. कितनी स्लाइड से नहीं हुआ है मैम?
दो स्लाइड इसके पहले. okay.
अभी हो रहा है मैम? हेलो
अब हो रहा है. अब हो रहा है. दो स्लाइड पहले पे दिखा दीजिए. दो पिछले स्लाइड बस जस्ट. हाँ एक और इसके. या, so, यहाँ से नहीं दिखा.
सो दीज आर द टू बी द काम नॉट ओनली फॉर द कोविड पेशेंट बट आल्सो फॉर द डॉक्टर्स. इट दे वेयर दीज आर द पोस्टर्स यूज्ड इन द वार्ड्स एंड इन द इंस्टीट्यूट for making the patients and even the doctors to be cool. Then still if it was said that if you are sad and you are getting the angry, you are very confused and very scared, then also it's okay. It's normal. Confront it and continue to live. Talk to someone and seek help and don't let it off like this. So the pandemic is going on, but there are so many violence, and so because of the violence also the another pandemic during the pandemic also occurred. And these are the different type of the news and different type of the advertisement which given, like this picture. See how many dead bodies are there. And so in these cases, this type of the cases, like 80% doctors are stressed, 70% have dealt with violence, 63% see their patient with some fear, and 58% thought of hiring security. So these are the another type of pandemic type of situations which occurring during the pandemic. So the factors main important during this are shifting burden of care to patient and public. Traditional discontent gets exaggerated during this pandemic. Misinformation by the social media and fake news, facing the morality, end of life care and explain high expenditure and sense of profiting by doctors. So these were the so many things which created the stress among the COVID patients, normal patient persons, and even the doctors. So violence during the pandemic, how to curb? Medical Protection Act, Ordinance 2020, no penal code, difficulty to lodge complaints. WHO regulations, all hospital to ensure, recognize it as public health challenge, improve public health services by states, ensure dignity and better work atmosphere of the individual workers, personal protection, and the stamp system to identify potential violence. Means we should know, the doctor and healthcare worker should know how to identify where the violence is going to happen. Like the person is staring, means he is wanting something and he can do something. His tone, anxiety, mumbling, so many things which can prevent the violence, and this can only be occurred due to support of all the public, not only with the healthcare workers. So in conclusion, doctors are gods and gods. They are heroes without capes. this is the wording of the Chief Justice of India. While prioritizing prevention and care of COVID patients, values and well-being of doctors are often neglected. This must be reviewed and considered while planning care during pandemic situations. Now, if we see how deadly this COVID is, the percentage mortality is only, the case fatality rate is only 3.4%. And if we see about the SARS, smallpox, MERS and Ebola, so much high. So don't be so much panic and provide the care to the patient. It's your duty, healthcare worker. And this is the last request to the healthcare worker, that keep the silence, keep the patience in yourself and see the case fatality rate. And with keeping yourself safe, you should provide the duty to the patient. And further, the discussion needed on practitioners. There are not the doctors which are only sitting on the institute, only sitting on the high medical colleges or the healthcare centers. But there are different type of systems, primary, secondary, and tertiary. So it is the point of discussion, what type of facilities should be there in those centers. Then we should take care of seniors versus juniors also. Ultimately, personal health is an individual responsibility. If a healthcare worker has respiratory symptoms and does not wish to endanger others, the onus is on them to stay back and give a proper explanation for their decision. It was seen that even the healthcare worker was telling that I am infected, I am suffering with the fever, even then they were called on the duty. So it's at least extent of the responsibility should be given to the healthcare workers. Then unethical issues for committing doctors. There are so many type of unethical issues, but why should only commit to the doctors? And so the discussion needs on these points also. No specification of good patient. Everywhere we are specifying the definition of the good doctor, but anybody has focus on this also, we should also specify who is the good patient, what are the good patients, and what are the qualities should be there in a good patient. Can he opt out? If he does not want to go in the COVID duty, whether he can opt out or not. So this actually I have taken from lot of literature from the journals, but I don't know whether I have done the justice or not, but these are the few important references. And if any questions are there, I welcome you. Thank you.
Dr. Suruchi, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. I think healthcare worker during the COVID time, everybody has faced this situation, and how beautifully you have explained the ethical issues. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your knowledge and showing this path to us. I would request the participants, if anyone has any question, please raise your hand and ask. We have an eminent speaker on board. Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Vijayalakshmi, I agree with you 100%. But as being the... by being heading some of the important things or important duties in the institution in COVID time, I understand what you were saying. It was really not ethical. For example, letting people opt out of the duty or letting them go from the duty, or lot number of things which you have said are correct, but were really not possible looking at the pressure that time. But I'm proud to see that institution like KGMU has actually provided a lot number of things, you said. For example, people were provided a stay, people were provided food, people were provided, they could live on the campus. So there were a lot number of things which were provided to them. In spite of them, they had to stay away from the family. They were scared that they go back and they might infect people. But actually, there were limited options. It was really war-like situation. You could not run away. I understand, like, being doctors, so you have to opt out, but that was really not an option. So there are a few things which I understand are dilemmas, and you have very beautifully said that. Thank you very much for bringing everything in one composite lecture. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure hearing to you.
Supporting. Thank you.
Professor Vimla ma'am, you have raised.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Vijayalakshmi. That was a very nice presentation, and you brought out a lot of points that are dilemmas and will continue, of course, to be dilemmas. I just had one question that you were talking about, that at institutional level, there should be some things to address the moral ethical dilemmas. And in the beginning, you had told us that there is a problem about how to distribute. One of the biggest ethical issues is how to distribute scarce resources, how to make decisions regarding patients, whom to treat, whom not to treat. So this dilemma, I feel, is not only during COVID times. Very often, you know, because in our overcrowded hospitals, and especially in the public health setting where there are more patients who require something from us than we can give, this dilemma is ongoing. So is there going to be some kind of regulatory mechanism, you know, a sort of something that will help doctors feel that they are right when they make a decision? Like often, you know, eventually we do ageist decisions. Like we say, we will offer less care to old people than young people. But we do it at individual levels. And often there is neither an institutional nor a regulatory mechanism or to help us, right? So these decisions sometimes weigh very heavily on the individual doctor. Is there any thought about setting up a mechanism to deal with this?
Very, very excellent question, ma'am. What happened, the WHO has already made this type of regulation, not exactly the regulation, but the guidelines, how to tackle this type of situation. MCI has only single line for the pandemic, that is, you are the doctors and you have to duty, perform your duty. But the NMC has taken over the charge now, because the crisis or the pandemic occurred during when we are in the NMC. So we would like to make the regulation according on these type of crisis also. So the at least the we can be benefited, or the healthcare vector, healthcare workers would be, not the all the healthcare workers, because the regulations which would be made mainly for the doctors, because the doctors are being registered here. So, but they all can utilize, not only the doctors, but the healthcare workers can also utilize these. And this would be done after the discussion with the meeting, arranging the meeting with different institutions and different expert groups. So the regulation can be finalized even after the COVID is finished. Then also we should be ready for other pandemic, and we should be ready for not even only the pandemic, but a small crisis which is going to happen anytime in the during the critical care of the patient.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
I think now Dr. Pradeep Sharma, sir has a query. Please.
I will just like to say that, first of all, on behalf of Georgian Alumni Association, I congratulate Dr. Vijayalakshmi for a wonderful lecture. And as Dr. Amita Jain was saying, that it is very difficult to decide the dilemma at the time of when there is a warlike situation. And what I personally think is, during that time, it is your personal experience that matters. And thereby you are supposed to take the decision, individual decision, at that spot only. Otherwise, if you are just going by the rules, it will be very difficult for you to say what to do, what not to do. Depending upon the situation, you will have to take the decision. And on behalf of the Georgian Alumni Association, once again, I thank Dr. Lai, Dr. Nag, and I also thank the Department of Microbiology, particularly Dr. Amita Jain, head, for taking pains and organizing this wonderful lecture series. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Sheetal Verma has raised the query. Ma'am, please.
Good morning, ma'am, for a wonderful lecture. So, mute kar dijiye, ma'am. One thing we saw, the district administrations were not supportive in many of the places, and the doctors were misbehaved, and we saw mass resignations of the doctors and the way they were insulted and humiliated despite of giving the best performances in the most scarcity and paucity which they could have done. And so what do you think, ma'am, in such situations government should be doing so that doctors' morale do not go down?
Yes, that's why the punishment should be definitely given to those harassing the doctors, and because of this the doctors are taking the resigning from the duty, because the doctors are the frontliners, the healthcare workers are the frontliners, and if they are not there, who is going to give the duty? So even if the one area of the people are suffering, it means they should be informed by the doctor and to be taken care of by the government, and this should be considered, not should be neglected. And basically what I am saying, that the maximum resignation happened to different few states for which I don't want to take the name. So in different states there were the resignation, but they were not informed properly to the central place. So the information from the state to the central place is required to for the further processing of any appeal. Thank you, ma'am.
Over to Professor Kalyan, sir.
Dr. Surochi, P.K. Sharma, sir, already gave his blessings on the in time of the questions. So please continue.
Dr. Surochi, I can see that the Vice Chancellor is still with the meeting. If he has any comment or query to me.
Yes.
VC sir, if you would want to say a few words. Maybe sir is busy. Maybe he is busy.
Okay.
Dr. Surochi, please give.
Okay, sir.
Vote of thanks.
Thank you. It's my immense pleasure to present the vote of thanks on this prestigious lecture series occasion. First of all, I want to thank my heartiest thanks to Professor V.L. Nag ma'am for her wonderful presentation, and I'm sure the knowledge and the pain you have presented for the healthcare workers, and it will show path to us. I thank Honorable Vice Chancellor sir for constantly supporting and motivating us for these kind of series. Thank you, sir, for your blessings. I thank all the members of Alumni Association present on this occasion. I thank faculty members as well as the participants and my friends. I think we can close down the series.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity.
It was a great pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.